3 to 5 words that best describe Gershwin Gordon.
3 to 5 is a little.
Okay.
But I would say family man.
Yes.
A believer. And passionate cook.
Awesome. I can see that you had to stop yourself there because you said as the man, hallelujah. So talk to us. Where are you from? Where were you born? Before we get into where you are right now and what happened over the past 10 years.
Well, I'm originally from Welkom, Free State. Not many people know Bronville. Small place, but yeah, that's where I was born and raised. And from there, I've been in between Welkom and Randfontein. And then that's why this always feels like home to me.
Yes.
Because my father lived here, and my grandmother, and my family lived this side, and then my mother was that side. So I was always in between the two places. Excuse me. And that's where I'm from.
How long ago did you, what happened that you found yourself saying that, you know what, I'm going to stay where you are, like in Gauteng and all that? Did something specific happen, or was it just opportunities?
Basically, at the time when I finished my studies in Bloem, obviously there was no hotels in Welkom that you can go study at or anything like that. I then went on to Cape Town. I was there for a very short period of time, about a year. That was my first job as a commis chef after studying 1 year hospitality management. And not specifically focusing on, cooking and being a chef, but that was one of the subjects which I excelled in. And I didn't even want to study. I just wanted to get into the job market to help my mother, you know, with finances and things like that.
Yeah.
But she was like, no, you need to go study. And knowing that there's no finances, you know, you don't even think about planning for these things.
Mm.
But I thank God for the sacrifice that you made, because then I could study 1 year hospitality management in a private hotel school out in Bloem. And that opened many doors for me. At the time, it seemed like, you know, the cheaper place, the only place that I could afford. But with that certificate, I then ended up in Cape Town, like I said, for about a year.
Mm.
Obviously, your first job, you have to pay, you know, rent, it's traveling, it's all of those things. And being so far away from home, it was not feasible. I think at that time, I was earning $1,006 a month. And I soon then came back to Joburg. I landed up in Absa Bank Market Street as a teller and consultant. And my goal for that was just to save up to go to the UK, like I said, because my the certificate I had then opened a door for me to go to the UK, because everybody was going with this work, you know, traveling visas and whatnot, working holiday visa.
Yes.
And my plan for that was basically, yes, to travel, but to explore the food industry that side, because there it was much bigger than what it is in South Africa.
Sure.
And yeah, after about 6 months saving up in Absa, I then landed myself in the UK.
Serious, man.
And that's where it all started. The UK was a bit of a culture shock. Obviously, being away from home, like I just said, it's difficult in Cape Town when I had my first job. But now in the UK, you got no, mommy, can you quickly give me 100 rand? Whatever the case may be, because if you look at the currency conversion, it's a lot more as well.
That's true.
But yeah, no, in the beginning, my best friend and I, Clayton Oliver, then went to we were under the impression we were going to go to London directly. But then the agency actually sent us to the wrong place. And there were some, you know, admin issues with it and so forth. And we ended up in Tynedrum. It's a little village.
Okay.
The most beautiful place I've ever seen in Scotland. And I kid you not, when you stand at the gate of this establishment we worked at, you can see the beginning of the little town and the end of it. But it's in a valley and it's just mountains and snow and everything. And never seeing so much snow. Yes, it snowed once in Welkom growing up, but it was the most beautiful thing. So for that experience, I enjoyed being there. But then also the chef position was taken, and I actually had to be a scholar. And a scholar is the overis kotel goed was. So yeah.
Wow.
And doing that, washing dishes and everything, I then always jumped into the kitchen. You know, I would finish what I need to do and I'd jump in, and that's where they saw my passion as well. But in the end, not wanting to be there and wanting to be in London, we stuck it out for a couple of months.
Yes.
We then went to London eventually, got a bus ticket, not knowing where we're going to land up. Got some context, got some Gumtree, you know, your South African houses and whatnot. Got set up that side, and we took a bus from Scotland to London. And that's where the real fun began, because it's London was a real culture shock in terms of food. Things were big there. You know, that's where your Gordon Ramsays come from, your Jamie Olivers.
Yes.
And I had a phenomenal time. I was jumping around from job to job, just being excited to work with who, you know.
How does one put a price tag on the value of good memories or special occasions with family, friends, and loved ones? At Gordon's Creations, we don't sell food, but an awesome service and experience that you will remember for many years to come.
for an unforgettable experience, elegance and delightful art on a plate, hire a private chef next time you have a function, from a romantic dinner for two with a private chef to intimate dinner parties, matric farewells to weddings and everything else in between. We also offer cooking lessons for individuals and small groups. Don't delay. Contact us on 072-281-9352 for any queries or bookings. You can also find us on Instagram at Gordon's Creations, Facebook under Gordon's Creations, or visit our website on www.gordonscreations.co.za and make your bookings to discover a new level of taste.
People should know that not everything just goes smooth, especially when it comes to passion, especially when it comes to something that you really want to do for the rest of your life. Did you stay there? How did you end up back? What happened?
As I said, then, like you said, the journey was awesome, traveling, getting to, you know, see different things and so forth. But then on my return to South Africa, I never planned to return, by the way, but I lost my sister and I made an emotional decision. Mm. I went back, came for the funeral, went back, finished my studies, and then I came back. Mm. Because after my visa then finished, I went on to a student visa because the hotel sponsored me. Then I could stay for an extended time. But yeah, like I said, that's what transpired and made my emotional decision, and I came back. So when I got back to South Africa, it was once again a culture shock, because now I've only been in one establishment, which was the Holiday Inn in Strand Street.
Yes.
And I saw how things were done. So experiencing all that amazing stuff there, where you make a sauce 24 hours, you start with a massive 50-liter pot, and at the end of the day, you're sitting with 1 liter, something like that. And then you come to South Africa and they tell you, just add hot water, you know, 2 minutes and things like that. And for me, it justified the purpose that I went overseas and what I experienced and so forth. But I've applied at a couple of places. I know the Lost City wanted me, because then the regional executive chef that I worked with in Cape Town then took over this side. And when he saw my CV, immediately called me, said he's not going to interview me, nothing, just start. And I'm like, okay, awesome. But how much am I going to look at earning?
Mm.
And he said, 3,500. Sure. Now, I know I cannot directly translate what I earned in the UK to what you're going to earn in South Africa.
Yeah.
But at that time, that was about my insurance cost. So, and I told him, and he's like, oh no, look at the perks. You eat for free, you stay for free, and you can go to the Valley of the Waves and all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm like, ah, no, thank you. It's not what I'm actually looking
for.
So now, knowing that this is all that I know how to do and have studied and so forth, I didn't have any other options. I just kept on putting my CV out, and I took the best paying job at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And yes, it's not all about the money, because I started cooking at the age of 12. So the passion was always there, but obviously you need to look after your own needs as well.
True.
And at the time, I worked for a company called Gam Gourmet, which was doing the Nedbank buildings catering out in Sandton. And their corporate, their canteen is basically like a restaurant style, you know, corporate catering. And they did events on the side as well. And they took me on as one of their senior chefs.
Hmm.
To get back to your question, how I left the industry is working for Gam Gourmet only for 1 year. And that was due to exploitation. And I'm not going to sugarcoat it or anything like that.
Yeah.
I realized that is what happens in the industry in South Africa. To give an example, I literally, as a senior chef, I would leave the kitchen 12, 1 o'clock in the morning, come home. I lived at the time with my sister, get into bed, 6 o'clock, I'm back at the kitchen, opening it again.
Sure.
And that's untold stories. You know, you fall asleep in traffic and things like that. You get lost because I'm new to Sandton. We don't have GPSs that time and all of these things.
Wow.
But bottom line, and that kind of put a sour taste in my mouth for the industry.
Okay.
The fact that, you know, they're shortcuts in the kitchens. Like I said, with the sauce example that I made, that they're taking shortcuts, and leftovers gets created into another dish for the following day.
Sure.
And the prices, the markups of those dishes are exorbitant and things like that. And that went beyond, you know, what I stand for in food and so forth, fresh and so forth.
I wanted to ask that. Was it totally based on that, or was it corruption behind the kitchen? Or like
not so much.
The quality? Was it about the quality for you?
Yeah, I would say the quality, because I believe in fresh and, you know, exquisite dishes and things like that. And yeah, we can turn out a chicken that you had standing there as a full chicken tomorrow, cut up in pieces, and then tomorrow it's in your sandwich. You know what I mean? And this is things that happen.
Wow.
But in the fine dining industry, obviously, you're using fresh ingredients every day. You use the best ingredients. You source your stuff and so forth. I remember, like, in the UK, people would even ask, what farm does the chickens come from, and what are they fed on, and things like that.
Wow.
Which is like, at first I'm like, what are these people asking? And I don't know what to say and whatnot. Yeah. But I learned there's a culture that people actually know, you know, the farms where your fruit grows and pesticides and, you know, if your cows are injected and things like that, which really makes a difference to the quality of the meat and so forth. And out here, I think at that time, we never had that knowledge or we didn't go to that extent, you know.
Yes.
To us, it's like there's beef and you just eat it, you don't care where it come from, what it was fed, what it was injected with and all of that.
That takes a level of commitment to your passion to leave the industry because of the corruption in the quality and saying this is not how I know it should be served and all that. After that, you went corporate, you started working.
Yes.
And then can you say it's a good thing because you met your wife, you started a family? What happened there?
I actually met my wife when I was in the UK. When I worked at Market Street.
Yeah.
Then the weekend that I came down for my sister's funeral, I met up with her and I said, listen, I'm going back to finish off things, but when I come back, I would like to be with you.
Oh, wow.
Now, where the story starts is, and I was going to complete the first question, and this is obviously going to cover both too, but with one
okay,
stuff.
Okay, okay.
So what happened is, at the time also, like I said, I would come home and drive past Triumph, go to Rivoli, knock on my wife's window, back then my girlfriend, just to see her. And then it's just high and by and a kiss through the window, chef, white stinking of food and everything. And I would go. But knowing that I want to become a family man and everything, I said, you know, this is not the life that I want to live, because I would not see them literally for 2-3 weeks. Oh, because I'm constantly at work and so forth. And what I'm producing at work is not even the level of food that I want to produce.
The dish that shocked me the most was the one with the muesli. That was my best dish.
What was on my menu today was something very unique, which I always had in mind. It was yogurt and muesli. I had an open steak sandwich. And to end it off, I had your classical Italian prosciutto with a sweet melon. The steak sandwich actually consisted of fillet steak. I had a blue cheese, cream cheese, mixed as a spread. I had your side salad with a nice vinaigrette. I used some truffle oil in that dish. That was basically my open steak sandwich with a classical fillet mignon. To end it off, like I said, I had a very nice prosciutto, top quality, a nice sweet melon, and just garnished that up a bit.
What made you come back? I think that's what people want to hear right now. What made you come back and say, you know what, not just to start a side hustle because of finances, but the fact that you are so committed to this.
Look, I registered Gordon's Creations in 2013, and it never really took off. I would do one function a year, two functions a year. There would be a year that I don't even do any function, but I just keep it registered, keep everything updated. Like, I've got a company sitting there. But I was always working, you know, and some people even thought that I'm working as a full-time chef, not knowing I'm working in a corporate environment, you know.
Sure.
And yeah, so the word spread by word of mouth. I would have someone call me, I've got a wedding, I've got a small function.
Yeah.
And that's how business would come to me. I would not go out marketing myself and looking for business.
Yes.
But I always say with all sincerity to people that has lost people during COVID, that's one, you know, if it wasn't for this pandemic, I wouldn't have been where I am now. We wouldn't have had this conversation because it is all due to COVID that I had to, you know, maneuver and fall back on my skill and talent, because it all came with, you know, people had job cuts, salary cuts, all of those type of things. And I was one of them.
Yes.
That one day, I mean, our salaries kept coming later and later in the month. And one day my boss just said, they called us all into the boardroom and said, listen, this month we cannot pay you. There is just no money to pay you. And I remember thinking to myself, how am I going to tell my wife this?
Yo.
Because, you know, finances is not that your marriage is built on that or whatever the case may be, but it is an important part when you've got your own responsibilities and things. But I thank God that when I approached her and I said, you know what, there's nothing I can do about this.
Yes.
Obviously prayed about it and so forth. And when I approached her, a response was exactly what I expected. She said, my husband, let's just pray about it, but God will take care of our every need. And from there on, God has really been carrying me. And month after month after month, I see his hand of provision on my life through falling back onto my talent and my skill and so forth.
Yeah. What were the challenges? Even though it sounds good, the pandemic gave you something else to hustle on, you know, an income and all that. But then what are the challenges up until this moment with regards to the people that approach you and don't come back because of the quotation or invoice and all that? How do you deal with all those things? Because of the quality that you believe in.
Look, that's a big challenge. And I don't want to stereotype and say, oh, well, people don't want to pay. No, yeah, it's not about that. It's all about affordability. I understand people would love to have this type of experience, but cannot afford it at that point in time. And I think not a lot of people realize what the cost is for something like that, what I give.
Yeah.
And I remember one of the first things that me and you did was with Darren and Ollie in August, when it was the Valentine's Day this year.
Yes.
And I charged them, I think it was R1,000. And that was just part of, you know, getting some marketing material and also doing what I, you know, trying to get some income. But R1,000, I think I served the 3-course meal and everything went well. We shot the video and Darren called me and he said, you know what, how can you do this? How can you charge for such excellent service R1,000? And he made me aware when you book him and you just have a 1-hour consultation, that's his service fee. Apart from the add-ons or whatever the case may be.
Yeah.
And it's like when you go to a doctor, you're going to pay your consultation and then he's going to do what he needs to do. And he's still going to send you to buy meds and all of those other expenses, you know. And I know, yes, it's I'm not a doctor, whatever the case may be, but just the examples that he put out there. And he told me that one thing I shouldn't do is sell myself short. And I think at the time I was just so desperate that I wanted to get material and I wanted to get back into the game and I wanted my, you know, stuff to be out there, market myself and so forth, that I said, you know what, I'm going to sell myself short and this is what I'm going in at. But people just see the pictures and yes, it looks like a simple 3-course meal, but at times I even drive up until Machalis to get some of my meat because of the quality of that. There's a place out in in Four Ways called Pescador. They know me very well. My posters are up there. If I walk in, they give me discount even when I buy one item or whether I buy 10. But because I'm such a good customer and I've built up a relationship with them, that's how it is. And I mean, their quality is amazing. I've got a lot of fisheries around the area that I live, but I drive all the way to Four Ways to get my fish from them. Now, there's things that people don't see that goes onto your plate. They just see there's a 3-course meal and there's time that goes into planning your menu, your costing, you're traveling to source all your ingredients, your prep time prior to me coming to your kitchen and then putting that together.
He's super talented. Very, very talented. And not an experience that you could easily get at home, or you would think that you couldn't easily get it at home.
Yeah.
And it was a beautiful experience and not something that we've ever experienced before.
Yeah. I think the one thing that stood out for me is the value that we got.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking if I took you to even one of the most expensive restaurants, I don't feel like we would have got this kind of value. So I'm honestly speechless.
Can you say it's because of the industry they allow this to happen? They allow the stigma to sit on our people, whereby it's not our people's fault. I don't know if I'm making sense in my question, but can you say it's because of that, or is it just a personal thing that people have? Like, I don't want to spend this much for food.
No, look, you've actually hit it. Excuse me, you've actually hit the nail right on the head. I would say more a lack of exposure. Also, besides the affordability, you know, aspect thereof.
Okay.
To give you a quick example, I had a neighbor that never did something romantic for his wife. And people that know me knows that I'm a romantic and I love surprises and things like that. Long story short, I helped him to arrange his anniversary for his wife. And he's like, no, she's not going to like this because I've never done this even. I said, but how do you know if you have never done it? And I told him, listen, if she doesn't like it, you blame it on me. If she likes it, you take all the credit for it. Bottom line, this guy's an IT guy working from home. And the Mr. Delivery scooter comes there 3-4 times a day.
Sure.
That's what they live from. Off.
Wow.
Mr. Delivery every single day. So I eat my 3-course meal for him and everything. And then it was a huge success. And he took all the credit because his wife, he loved it. But he came back and told me, you know what? I never knew food could taste like this.
Wow.
And since then, he stopped, you know, with the Mr. Delivery 3-4 times a day. And he actually tries to cook a meal himself a day.
That's
amazing.
He
would always ask me for, you know, recipes, ingredients, things like that. And to see that is you
amazing.
Know, it's really, it's just amazing.
Yo, my bro.
So the menu was basically straightforward. It was an amuse bouche, which is a seafood amuse bouche that I did with some burnt lemon. I had salmon and prawns and squid sauteed off in a pan, with a velouté mixed into that, and with a caviar on top of the guacamole.
The lemon, the salmon, and everything that was in the bush. It was lovely. It's almost like, you know, like I didn't want to eat anything after that because of the taste that was in my mouth. It was something that it almost
savor.
You wanted to savor it, but it also like awakened something. Yeah, so that was lovely.
Let us conclude our conversation. What is it that you can maybe just encourage somebody with wherever they are when it comes to passion? When it comes to passion, and I mean financially, you're not where you would like to be right now. But what helps you? What keeps you? You know, the drive and all that. I know about the quality and all that. But then when you wake up in the morning, is it still worth it for you?
No, look, it's definitely worth it. I always tell my wife, do not wake me up and ask me to make up the bed or cut the grass or take out the bin. I'm not that kind of guy.
Okay.
But if she can wake me up at 5 o'clock and say I want to have a breakfast at 7, I would be up anytime. That's how much I love cooking.
And it doesn't matter what is in the fridge, you'll do something.
I make it happen. But to come back to your question, you know, it is so cliche that people always said, you know, I've been to many business seminars and all of these things. And the one thing that always stands out, and I thought it's just a saying, you know, basically, in word and an over eight, when people say, follow your passion and money will follow you. And the one thing that I was running away from today, just by returning back into the game and doing what I love doing, money is starting to follow me. And like I say, it is truly, I've explored many other businesses. I've lost a lot of money. I was in logistics. I owned a truck. I've tried a lot of other things, but believe you me, this was the easiest to fall back on because it's what I love to do. To go back into logistics and get on, you know, it's a mission, man. It's going to take a lot out of me. But this is something that comes naturally, not just because I've got the skill. Like you said, I've been out of the industry for so long, but I always kept myself relevant because all I watch on TV is food shows and news now and then. But yeah.
But news about food.
I binge on food shows. I can finish a series on things if it interests me. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And that's how I kept myself relevant as well, because I would literally see a dish and not look at the illustration or what it is and whatever the case may be, and just visualizing it. And then I think, how am I going to recreate this? And I would literally go and do it. I mean, my wife always tells a story that never did she go to a braai or invite people over. And at 11 o'clock or 12 o'clock, you get a dessert after braai. And that's what my bringing braai used to be like. Because I would just think, you know what, I quickly want to whip up something for you guys.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I've got a sweet tooth, I must say. So then I would make a 15-minute microwave chocolate, you know, lava cake and garnish it up and everything. And yeah, I'm serving people when you were to bring in braai. Yeah, follow your passion and don't underestimate yourself, because sometimes, I mean, I'm one of them that used to look for funding and this. And, you know, you just think business, you must have funding. But yes, not every thing is as easy as cooking, because I've got all the stuff in my house already. I've got pots, I've got pans, I've got the skill and so forth. But let's say you're a mechanic. I'm sure your father's got a toolbox there. You're helping him and things like that. Or, you know, look what you've got in your hands and what you can start with. Don't look for the money to come first.
Yes.
But build your way up, build your reputation up and so forth. Sure. And believe you me, the doors that will open for you is amazing.
We thank God for people like yourself that are really, you know, you go through the struggle in order for this to create a new culture in this industry, because the more we complain about this and we leave corruption in the quality will continue. But when you stay there and you fight through the ups and the downs, money, no money, it means you create something so that the next generation can live from what your blood and your blood, sweat and tears. And I thank you for the fact that you are still hanging in there.
If you want to book me, please check out my page on Gordon's Creations. My number is 0722 819352, or check out Gordon's Creations on Facebook or on Instagram. Thank you.